Good morning.
Good morning.
Grace and peace be to you from God and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I want to welcome you to this service for First Presbyterian Church here in Pilot Mountain. A few announcements. This week there will be no Bible study. I will be out of town, but we will resume on the 23rd with chapter 3 from Philip Yancey's book, The Jesus I Never Knew. It's been a good study. We'll be again on Zoom, and I will send out that link the Monday before. These days' devotionals for January through March are normally available in the vestibule near the front door of the sanctuary. However, the front door opening has been closed and still is closed as far as I know, awaiting new doors. Pilot Outreach this month is needing the following items: soup, stew, and chili. So if you have any questions about that, see Deborah Alford or call Pilot Outreach as well. Are there any announcements that I might have missed? There is one I just thought of. There is to be a congregational meeting directly following this service. So those who are here will be a part of that as well. If you would please join me as you are able in our call to worship. The Lord is sovereign. Let the people tremble in awe.
God is enthroned upon the treasure. Let the earth shake.
The Lord is great in Zion. He is high above all peoples.
Proclaim the greatness of the Lord our God and the greatness of God on the holy mountain.
Scripture says if we say that we have no sin, we are found to be lying, and God is not with us. So let us take this time to join together and confess our sins to God and to each other in our unison prayer of confession. Let us pray. God of compassion, in Jesus Christ we behold your transforming light, yet we continue to live in darkness, preoccupied with ourselves. We fail to see your work in the world. We speak when we should listen. We act when we should reflect. Empower us to live in your light and to walk in your ways for the sake of him who is the light of the world, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Hear the good news. While it is true that we have sinned, It is a greater truth that we are forgiven through God's love in Jesus Christ. To all who humbly seek the mercy of God, I say, in Jesus Christ, your sin is forgiven. Thanks be to God. And if you would join me now for our unison prayer for illumination, printed in your bulletin. Lord Jesus, your majesty surpasses all that your disciples could have imagined. Your goodness exceeds all that we think or understand. As your word is proclaimed today, open our minds and hearts to perceive your majesty and goodness more fully and to respond in joy. Amen. Our first scripture lesson is found in the book of 2 Kings, chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. Listen now to the words of the Lord. Now when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of prophets who were there in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. Keep silent." Elijah said to him, "Elisha, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho. The company of prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he answered, "Yes, I know. Be silent." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went and stood at some distance from them, as they were both standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his mantle and rolled it up and struck the water. The water was parted to the one side and to the other until the two of them crossed on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you." Elisha said, "Please, let me inherit a double share of your spirit." He responded, "You have asked a hard thing. Yet if you see me as I am being taken from you, it will be granted you. If not, it will not." As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them, and Elijah ascended in a whirlwind into heaven. Elisha kept watch and crying out, "Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." But when he could no longer see him, he grasped his own clothes and tore them into two pieces. And our second reading comes from the Gospel according to Mark, chapter 9, verses 2 through 9. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up to a mountain high apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud came a voice, "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. These are the words of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. It is common for folks who have come back from Montreat or another retreat center to be a bit different for a while. They may seem a bit more preoccupied with the eternal rather than the temporal. They may speak in terms that were not words or phrases. phrases that they had used before, more mystical rather than practical. All too often, after some time goes on, they return to normal and go about their daily lives. But sometimes, there is a permanent change in someone. They don't really know how to explain it, but something has happened. All that they know is that they have been somehow, some way, changed by their experience. And there's a term for where such places, or for a place where such things happen. It's known as a thin place, where the boundaries between the visible world and the invisible become soft and porous, when a veil lifts just a bit, a place where heaven and earth almost meet, a place where heavenly glory shines down in the world. It is said that Montreat is that kind of place. And at Montreat, there is a spot where one understands this much more fully. It's called Lookout Mountain, and it's about 623 feet high. And from the top, one can see all of the surrounding area and marvel at creation. And from there, one can fully understand that there is a thin place and that heaven is very near. Our scripture today tells of a thin place. Prior to the reading today, Jesus was teaching his disciples and asked who they believed him to be. Peter answers with the well-known declaration that Jesus is the Messiah. But there is a further teaching. There is the teaching that Jesus must suffer and die. And this is a hard teaching, and Peter feels the need to remind Jesus that this should never happen to him, that the Messiah is not one who will suffer, but one who will conquer. Jesus tells Peter that he is thinking as human beings think, not as God thinks, rebuking him for his concern that Jesus might be mistaken. Jesus then goes on to state that anyone who wishes to follow him must take up their cross and die to themselves. What a strange and powerful teaching this is. And after this teaching, 6 days to be precise, Jesus takes Peter, James, and John up a high mountain. Now, I want you to imagine walking to the top of Pilate Mountain. Just imagine that for a moment. Now, yes, I understand it entirely. Imagine what it would be like to have no road to follow, just a path hacked out of the brush and the trees and the bushes. Imagine how you would feel reaching the top. Now imagine that the hike is even further than going up to the top of Pilate Mountain. And you get an idea of the high mountain, which Mark tells us. I know for myself I get tired just thinking about it. But this is what Jesus and the disciples did. And when they reached the top, I'm sure the disciples sat down to have a rest and to recuperate from their journey. But they're in for a brand new experience as well. See, while they're resting, Jesus is transfigured, or more appropriately, transformed. His clothes are brighter and whiter than any bleach could make them. And he is looking what they believe divine beings should look like. Now, this transformation from human to what Jesus really is, divine. And the disciples get a front row seat for this. And as they're watching this scene unfold, they are astounded as Elijah and Moses both join Jesus. How they know that this is Elijah and this is Moses, I don't know. We're never told. Personally, I like to think of Jesus making introductions all around. Peter, James, John, Elijah, Moses, Peter, James, and John. How would you all, you know, get to know one another for a few minutes? But this is, I believe, Mark telling us that these are Peter, James, and John, or Elijah and Moses, with Peter, James, and John, and Jesus, so that those listening afterwards will know who is there. But after they meet these two giants of the faith, of the Jewish faith, Peter, always Peter, makes a new statement. He says that they should build 3 shelters or booths to commemorate the event that has just happened there. Now, this may have been the first thing that popped into his mind after realizing that he and the others were absolutely petrified with fear. This making of the booths was probably to be in line with the festival of booths that celebrated the Exodus of long ago. How better to commemorate the sight of Moses than to celebrate the Exodus? But then suddenly a cloud covers them all. Now imagine for a moment that the clouds cover the Menahah of Pilate Mountain. Very easy to see. This is what that would be like. If they were not scared before, I'm sure that they were now. From the cloud, a voice comes and says, "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Now, the first part of the statement, "This is my son, the beloved," is the same statement that was made with Jesus after his baptism. However, the disciples did not hear this as they were not present at the baptism. But if they had, they would have realized that the second part of the message was a different message. The first time it was, "This is my son, the beloved, with whom I am well pleased." This one, however, is "listen to him." It's an imperative to listen to what Jesus has to say to them, whether it be a teaching or telling them that he is to be crucified at the end of the journey to Jerusalem that is now just beginning. They are words that Jesus has signified and exposed for who he truly is. And when the cloud moves on, there is no one around but Jesus and the three. And as they travel back down the mountain, Jesus tells them that they are not to tell anyone about what they had seen. This was not to be told until the Son of Man had been risen. Now, this is a story with much symbolism. Mark is harking back to many things in the history of Israel. The first is the two men who are with Jesus. Elijah was a prophet who was taken up into heaven on a chariot of fire, as told in our first reading. He was also believed to be the one who would come before the Messiah in the end times. Moses, of course, was Moses, the greatest of all prophets, the one who had led the children of Israel out from slavery in Egypt. There are words, few words, that can tell us how important Moses was to the Jewish faith. And they are both there showing the significance of the moment. But even more is their positions. They are to the right and to the left of Jesus, who is at the center. This tells the disciples and us that Moses and Elijah are subordinate to Jesus. The one in the center is the one for whom all had been waiting to arrive. There are other symbolic moments here. Both Moses and Elijah had mountaintop moments. Now for Moses, he took three persons with him, and when he went to the top of Mount Sinai, there was a cloud that covered the top of the mountain, and there God spoke to Moses. Do you see what's happening here? Mark is telling those listening to the story that they are to recall the greatest of the ones of their faith, the ones of Israel who had been the standard bearers of the faith. And they are to realize that they pale in comparison to the one that Jesus, or the one that the voice had told them to listen to. Jesus was exposed for who he really was and really is. The man of mystery, the one who told demons to keep his identity secret, is now known for who he is, the beloved. He is shown to be greater than Elijah and Moses both, and his secret is now out. But he is not the only one who was exposed on the mountaintop. The disciples are also exposed, though not necessarily for good reasons. These are men who have traveled with Jesus and listened to his teachings, watched him heal, and heard him order demons to be silent. Yet even with all these things that they saw, they did not understand who Jesus was. They had been told by the voice in the cloud who Jesus was, and that they were to listen to him, something that they should already have been doing. They are as exposed as not understanding what is going on. Peter's suggestion of building three shelters was surely accepted by James and John. All three were terrified and could think of nothing else to say. But it shows that they were thinking of things in a human mindset. And it is fitting today The mountain where it is believed that this meeting took place has nothing on top of it but a Franciscan house for those who take care of the site. Those who visit cannot stay there. There are no plaques or anything that says, "This is the place where Jesus was transformed," as one would expect. There are no campgrounds or anything or any place where someone can come for a pilgrimage. And that's how the Franciscans want it to be. They believe that if Jesus did not want booths to be set up there, there should not be anything today that takes away from the experience of the mountaintop. It exposes again how the disciples looked upon this experience with human eyes. We are also exposed. We have the same inclinations as the disciples. Like them, we miss the signs and the wonders that we see and hear that tell us who Jesus is. Like them, we want to have the mountaintop experience that will never end. And so we are exposed for what we are and what we are not. G.K. Chesterton said that one sees great things from the valley, only small things from the peak. If you go to the top of Pilot Mountain, you can see a lot of the area, but things are quite small. It's when you come down from the top that you realize that some of the very tiny things are rather large and rather great. And that is what it is like when we are on the mission from God that God has set us on. We could stay on the mountain. We could come to church. We could be comfortable. But God has called us to go into the valley after seeing the glory of the transformed Jesus. We are called to take our place in the work of God and in the story of Jesus. Unlike the three disciples, we know who Jesus is, and we know what we are called to do. We are called to be in the valley. And while it may seem that we know what we are to do, we are exposed by what we do and what we do not do. Those who experience the thin places at Montreat know that they cannot stay there. For if they did, the work of the kingdom would never get done. But there is good news. Jesus did not turn away from the disciples for what they said and wanted to do. He continued to teach them, to go with them on the journey to Jerusalem, and to let them continue to see him in what he said and did. And they did listen to him. Though they had a hard time of it, in the end they got the message that had been told them by the voice in the cloud, that he was the beloved and that they should listen to him. But we have the same problems that the disciples have. But like them, if we listen, we will know what we have to do and where to go to tell the good news. We will be exposed for who we really are, children of God. Are we ready? Amen. Our affirmation of faith this morning is the faith of our baptism in the Apostles' Creed. So let us state together what we believe. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As we go now to God and the prayers of the people, I ask that you turn to page 6 of your bulletin and look over our prayer request. And as we pray today, when I say the words, "Lord, by your Spirit," in unison we say, "Grant what we ask." So let us go now to God in prayer. Mighty and merciful One, you come to us in glory. And now we come to you in prayer. We pray for your glorious creation. We ask that you stamp out the fires of destruction and wildfires wherever they be, that you drive away the clouds of pollution that clutter our skies, that you restore the beauty of this world. Lord, by your Spirit, grant what we ask. We pray for the body of Christ. Open our hearts in faith. Enlighten our minds with knowledge. Strengthen us to proclaim the gospel. Expose to us who you really are, and expose us for what we are as well. Lord, by your Spirit, grant what we ask. We pray for the peoples of all nations. Show the nations your vision of justice. Offer the leaders your mantle of wisdom, and give the people your blessings of peace. Lord, by your Spirit, grant what we ask. We pray for those who are perishing, whether by sickness, by the COVID-19 virus, or by other illnesses. We ask that you feed those who are starving, comfort those who are suffering, and receive the dying into your arms. Lord, by your Spirit, grant what we ask. We pray for those whom we love. Bless our families, our friends, and neighbors. Help them in times of trouble, whatever they may be. And be near when they are afraid. Lord, in your Spirit, grant what we ask. Holy One, make us ready for the day when this world is transfigured, transformed, and made new. When all things will shine in the dazzling light of your glory. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Shines upon you with beauty, blessing, and peace, now and forevermore. Amen.